Let's look at the theory of the median voter, one stylized account of democratic decision-making. In general, the evidence suggests that democracies give us better economic policy and definitely better human rights records. See the video on democratic evidence for more on this topic. But still, economists do not usually romanticize democracy. It's another decision-making process, and it actually has a lot of imperfections and flaws. Let's look at that more closely. Consider a simple model of what is sometimes called one-dimensional politics. One-dimensional politics means you can arrange people's views on a line where here is, say, the left wing, and here is the right wing, and here are individuals in the center, and anyone's views fall somewhere on this line, extreme left, center, or on the right. The people on the left wing agree with each other about pretty much everything, economics, foreign policy, civil liberties, as do the people on the right wing or the people in the center. So there's one kind of general dimension of tug-of-war in society under this assumption, and furthermore, a particular seat in the legislature is winner-take-all. If you get one more vote, well, that seat is yours. Those are the key assumptions here. They don't literally describe any single real-world country, but this is just a way of building an abstract model so we can get a general sense of how electoral pressures operate. Now let's consider the median voter theorem. The median voter is the voter in the middle, or the most centrist voter, or you could say, in a way, the most typical voter in society. And here, imagine you have a normal distribution of voters with a lot of individuals clustered here in the center, a smaller number with more extreme left-wing views, and a smaller number with more extreme right-wing views. Furthermore, now imagine you have two parties competing for the loyalty of this electorate. A given voter will stand somewhere on this line, say here, and that voter, by assumption, will choose the party which is closest to his or her point of view. So if you're a voter here, and two of the other parties are here and here, well, you're going to vote for this party here in the center. That leads to competitive pressures for both parties to move very close to the center and locate themselves at or near the center, because if you're a party and you move away from the center, well, you're losing some votes from at or near the center, and the people you're moving closer to on the extreme right or left sides of the distribution, well, they were going to vote for you anyway. The vote-maximizing thing to do with competition across parties, free and fair competition, is to locate at or near the center. Again, no one is saying this is literally true. There may be real-world forces which move you a bit away from the center, such as the need to win a party primary or the need to raise funds from donors. But still, in any system where there's actual real voting, to consistently win or contend for elections, what you need to do is have points of view which are not so far away from most of the voters. What are some possible advantages of having something that operates a bit like the median voter model? Well, for one thing, you get centrist politics. Of course, people who are not at the center don't think that's an advantage. Perhaps most importantly, you manage to get rid of the very worst rulers. Whatever the imperfections of democracy may be, if there's a truly terrible ruler or leader, that person can, and indeed probably will, be voted out of office. And most generally, you have vigorous competition between the two parties, so they monitor each other and they hold each other accountable and they uncover information when the other party does something wrong. What are the possible disadvantages? Well, in a median voter model, virtually all voters are not decisive. That is, their vote doesn't matter. It's that one voter or a very small number of voters right at the center who are deciding who wins. And if most voters are not decisive, how much time, effort, intelligence, information will they put into learning about politics? Very often, not that much, and you have a large number of voters who adhere to many economic fallacies, or they hold views called feel-good views, just to feel good about themselves, whether or not that view will be effective in practice. And to often an astonishing degree, voters remain uninformed or underinformed in democracy. Those are really some major flaws. Again, we're not saying that autocracy or dictatorship does better. What we are saying is we need to have a realistic sense of what democracy can and cannot achieve. Some particular biases of voters have been studied by our colleague Brian Kaplan, and Kaplan, using survey evidence from the United States, lists a few of these biases. One is what he calls make-work bias, which is to just focus on whether jobs are being created and not on whether those jobs are producing useful output. Another is anti-foreigner bias, very common in democracies. pessimism bias, people think economic conditions are worse or worsening than they really are, and also anti-market bias when it comes to understanding, say, the benefits of trade or the problems with price controls. People don't really understand as much as professional economists do, and furthermore, they often make mistakes in an anti-market direction. The particular mistakes often depend upon the country under consideration, but you'll find a lot of biases like these around the world and not just in the United States. Two more potential disadvantages of democracy, at least from some points of view. The first is that voters from the center, they often feel unrepresented or uninvolved because it's the center that's winning all the time. Again, that doesn't have to be a bad thing, but it's often believed that a parliament or Congress would be better if there could be more diversity of represented views. So toward that end, a lot of democracies have moved to a form called proportional representation, which is different from winner-takes-all. Let's take a look at that. Proportional representation hands out seats, say, in parliament, on the basis of the percentage of votes won. So to give one very simple formula, imagine if you get 40% of the votes, you get 40 seats. 30% of the votes, you get 30 seats. 20%, you get 20 seats. 10% of the vote, you get 10 seats. It doesn't have to work that simply or exactly. It's just an example. Under proportional representation, you then have parties form a coalition to rule. So you could imagine the lead party with 40 and the other party with 20 teaming up, and they would have 60. That would be a majority. There will be greater diversity of opinion expressed in Parliament, and you can say that the process is more representative, and some of the people a bit closer to the extremes will find their views represented in Parliament. But still, the final outcomes don't have to be either better or necessarily more representative, because in the case of this coalition, for instance, you have the party that won 40 getting its way on most things, and then to create the coalition, the party that won 20, well, they'll give that party its way on a few issues, and you still have, you know, partial rule by the 40% and partial rule by the 20%. That may or may not be better than the median voter theorem. We can say that proportional representation is a more popular form of democracy in today's world. But when you look at the key flaws and problems with democracy, namely its informational flaws, proportional representation has pretty much the same problems as the winner-take-all median voter systems. This is a big topic, and we've just scratched the surface. Here are some terms you could Google. There are also two very good classic books you could read, Anthony Downs' Economic Theory of Democracy and Brian Kaplan, The Myth of the Rational Voter.